A couple of months ago, I made a video about why I don't like CNC, but look what I got here. CNC parts. Got linear rails and ball screw for the long axis, another one for the axis across, and one for the Z axis. Sent to me by Viver because they liked the videos I made about some of their other stuff, even though I've been very critical. And then I've got some servos here, also closed loop steppers, so really, I've got, I think, most of what I need. Because I don't care enough about CNC to spend a lot of money on it, but already having most of the pieces, might as well try. So a typical arrangement for a CNC is a bit like this, with the gantry moving on these two linear bearings and the ball screw on either side, but I've only got one ball screw, and buying another one actually is not cheap. So I was thinking about maybe putting the ball screw in the middle underneath the table, but that gets complicated. But instead I'll try this. So my table is going to move on these rails with a screw in the middle. And that's really suboptimal because I can't get the full length of table as I would if I actually moved the gantry, but it's much easier to build that way. I'm experimenting with layout here. Part of the problem is this ball screw is way longer than I need, so the motor's going to stick way out. And also figuring out how much range of motion I'm going to have, how big the tables are going to be. But I think I need to switch to CAD before I start cutting up pieces of wood. And 3 hours later, here's my design so far. This is actually bigger than it looks. This is looking at the side of it one-to-one compared to my hand. And here's mounting the rails for the Y-axis, and I like to ensure those are parallel by just putting a wooden spacer between them. Both are exactly the same length, and that way they won't slide around when I screw them down. Got the ball screw and servo mounted for the table, and it's connected with one of these spider couples that actually came with the ball screws, but these are all for quarter-inch stepper motors, so I have to mill these out quite a bit. And to prevent flex while I clamp it in the lathe, I have a shim to go in here. Well, I got it down to 1.5. I'll call that good. I bought myself a drill chuck to go in here, but that's got way too much stick out and flex. So now I've just got a collet adapter and a 10mm drill in here. And I forgot to turn on the camera while I was actually drilling that. That should be good now. Got my coupling installed here, and then the motor hung way out here, so I had to add this mount here. And I'm holding the motor more towards the back, because that way the front can wiggle around a bit more, because none of this stuff is super precise. And on the other end belongs actually one of these blocks here, but that sticks out way too far. The bearing on this side I don't think is really necessary. Its main purpose is to keep this ball screw from flopping around too much, because it might not be entirely straight if it's spinning very fast and the carriage is way over here. And I use the same method to attach this motor here. Again, the only thing I care about is that the motor doesn't spin, and having the front flange not fixed in place means I have a little bit more wiggle room in terms of things being imprecise, because it's all wood and wood screws and drywall screws. I'm feeling a bit meh about progress on this machine, so I figure it'd be fun to at least get one axis moving with its motor. But the thing is, these motors are really fast and really powerful, so I gotta protect the machine against accidents. So for starters, I've installed a limit switch down here, and that runs along this rail, so when it runs off the end of this rail, that will disable the motor. But because these motors can go at 3000 RPM, the whole thing might still have a little bit of inertia even when it gets past the stop. So I want some kind of a cushioned crash stop, so this is gonna attach to the bottom side of the table, and it's going to ram into these blocks here, and this packing material is going to absorb any remaining momentum, and this dowel sticking out on here is basically just to keep that in place with a hole in here so that it can go on here and compress this material without damaging the machine. And that crash zone is going to take up about 5 centimeters of otherwise usable table travel, but I just want to play it safe for now. Half a stop mounted here. And simulating a bit of weight on the table. And even at 3000 RPM, the table's not gonna move that fast. Got my controller hooked up, limit switch hooked up too. And let's see if I let go of the limit switch. Yeah, that stops it. Excellent. And let's see how fast I can spin that ball screw without a table. Whoa. So that was up to about 2000 RPM and the status is lost phase. Thank you. if I manually crank this, this is the exact spot where the limit switch cuts out. And now slamming against the limit switch at full speed. So I overshot by 16 millimeters. So if I release that now, that was not very much compression on my cushion. So I should be safely able to reduce that crash zone to 20 millimeters, but I'll leave that for later. That motor wiggles around quite a lot. Good thing I gave it wiggle room. Almost 0.2 millimeters, and I think it's this spider coupling. And as I turn this, I can see the outside of the coupling moves, so it's not like I have failed to drill the hole in the middle of it. But the same day that I milled these out, these things arrived, which is actually the correct size spider coupling. Well, that's about four times better than it was. I was just testing my Y-axis by driving it with a drill, and it left a screwdriver in here. And without me even noticing the force from it on the drill, it totally dug in here and smashed this piece here. And this is why limit switches and the crash zone to make it stop are so important. But I had to use two limit switches, one on this end and another one here. And the other part of the stop will be this block here, which goes on the bottom here, right next to this block. And that's going to hit some crash pads here and here. Crash pads are installed, but this drill doesn't respect limit switches, so I like to crank it into the stops by hand. There's the click, and I can feel resistance already. We're on the crash pad. It's a bit loud moving at full speed, but let's try ramming it into the stops. So the fact that this actually ended up rotating back a bit means there's quite a bit of pressure on the crash pad, but there's no bang or anything, so that's safe. And now let's try the other side. But that Y-axis is going to have to carry the Z-axis, which is two linear bearing sets, plus the ball screw, plus a motor, plus a rotor, which is more than 5 kilograms altogether. I think these two weights should be fairly representative of that. So far so good, but that was only 3/4 speed. So even though my Y-axis has to move more mass than the table, it looks like the smaller crash zone and crash pads are adequate. The next step is to build the Z-axis on top of my Y-axis, and that involves two sets of linear bearings and the ball screw and a motor for that, and then a platform on top of that, and a rotor or some kind of spindle on top of that. But I'm not entirely happy with how this part came out. I've got a whole lot of spare holes here, measurement errors, and then some of these holes I've had to expand sideways a little bit because they weren't placed quite right. So really, I should make this piece again. So ideally for that, I'd have some kind of precision XY drilling machine, and it's out of the range of motion of this machine that I built. So rebuilding this part will be a project for my CNC router. And that'll be really handy because actually I can't think of many projects where it'd be really useful for other than making a bunch of gears. So I decided to drill the next set of holes with an absolute reference using a DRO on my homemade XY drilling machine. Aw, shit! This last hole ends up right on the edge. Did I miscalculate my numbers here? It turns out the holes are, in fact, in the right place, except for this one, which I just drilled after going, oh shit, just to show it's in the wrong spot, too close. The problem is I cut this piece to the same width as this, but the linear bearing blocks are actually wider than the base for the supported rods, so this piece needs to be wider, and I just need to cut a new one. So those should be precisely spaced holes to fit those things here. Next set of holes go here, but I don't have enough range of motion on here, so I have to reposition the workpiece, unfortunately. And I still need mounting holes for this ball screw nut. And being too afraid of measuring from the wrong side or making some kind of gross error, I just marked this with a tape measure, and I'm going to use the D-arrow to get the precise location. This is a very satisfying fit because even though the holes have no slack for the screws, they just line up with the threads in the linear bearing block. Only problem is I haven't got enough of the right kind of screws yet, so I'm just going to leave half of these empty. But then I immediately removed this thing again because I still had to add the stops. So here's my bottom stop, nice and sturdy with a crash pad. And the top stop is just against this bearing block. Basically this hits this. That makes it a bit soft, and this motor is not as powerful, so I figure the crash pads should be enough safety. I don't think I need limit switches. Got the closed loop stepper hooked up to a Raspberry Pi. Let's ram it against the bottom stop. And now the top stop. Oops. I didn't leave enough clearance for the motor here, so it just rammed the motor up and that disengaged the spider coupling. I guess that is a form of safety stop. So I could cut that plywood off here to make more room, but I realized also I need to have this come down a bit further just to mount the router on better, so I might as well just drill new holes and move it down. But before I do any of that, I want to see how much this thing can lift. Oops. I guess that is enough weight to back drive the screw. But with the motor on there, but disabled, it just barely doesn't back drive. But that's okay, because that weight is way heavier than the rotor I'm planning to use. I thought I'd do my initial tests with a pen holder that I made instead of a router. And I wrote a program that allows me to jog the motors using the cursor keys. And looking at what I drew, it looks like my y-axis has got quite a bit of backlash, because if I go this way and come back, it doesn't line up. Whereas the x-axis, if I do a little bit of x-axis movement and I keep moving to y, I don't get that. Now, part of the backlash was that the pen had a bit of play here, but this rubber band always pushes it to one direction, and I still have backlash. And then looking around, the motor always goes to the same spot, but this can move a little bit, and I realized my ball screw nut, the screws on this are loose and they're behind this, so I have to take this all apart again just to tighten those screws. But it gets worse because one of the screws for the nut back here is behind this part here, and this part is screwed behind the ball screw here, and that means I have to take the ball screw off to get that screw. So this test looks like it worked perfectly with these stair steps. This one I went too fast and had the control parameters set wrong for that. This one looks good. Maybe a bit of error. This one's much better. This one, maybe a tiny bit of error on it. I think I'll call that good. Looks like 0.03 millimeters of backlash on the table travel, or just over 1 thou. I'd like to remake some of these plywood parts more precisely with my CNC now, but I've got a whole lot of extra M6 screws that are countersink screws, so I want to use those, but getting those countersinks in there accurately after I drill the hole is difficult. But instead of switching to a V-bit for that, I want to use the straight bit and approximate that just by kind of spiraling down to make that tapered hole. Something like this. And my plan was to just attach the rudder mount with a bunch of wood screws, but then I realized if I make these carriage bolts in here longer so they can go all the way from the back here, that makes it much easier. Now, I didn't want to take this part off right now, nor did I want to drill it freehand, so I'm just going to use my machine and the router to drill the holes. I haven't got any numerical control yet, so I'm just jogging it with the cursor keys to make those cuts. Okay, time to try a countersink in wood. Looks a bit messy. Then I tried to drill the hole by manually jogging, but I hit the wrong button. And there's my new countersink hole, and screw fits in perfectly. That looks much better. Now, wanting to make this part more accurately, I drew a layout in SketchUp, and these vertical line segments represent the hole positions because those are really easy to parse out of the Collada file without actually understanding the file using just a simple Python script. I modified my pen holder to go into the router holder, and for starters, I'm just going to draw that layout on a piece of paper. And then trying it in a soft piece of scrap wood. And then finally in the plywood. And I need to do some tool changes for the smaller holes. My very first CNC part, now I just have to install it back here in the machine. Got my new Z-axis base installed now, and that was actually a bit frustrating because I had a couple of holes in the wrong spot because there was a CAD error, but it was nice to have all the other holes bang on in place. And I fine-tuned the Y-axis angle and screwed that one down. And then I did a quick check of the table just by scanning it along with a pen. And it definitely has a high spot along here, which is no surprise because I'm using cheap plywood and it's got overlapping plies right here. Flat enough for now. And then I spent a whole lot more time tweaking the alignment of my Z-axis.
Man, this CNC thing sure sucks up a lot of time. I'm not convinced it's worth it.
As for the bits that I didn't pay for directly, there's these servos by DMM Technology, and they're very nice because I can really tweak how they behave by changing the motion parameters, and they also don't lose steps, and they can turn very fast. Here's the other one. I flipped the base around so that the motor wouldn't be on the front, so it'd be easier for me to reach the router. As for the three sets of linear rails and ball screws, Weaver offered to send me a product of my choice for free. Figured it would end up in a video, so I picked these rails, and sure enough, they ended up in a video. And I'm pretty happy with the quality of the linear rails and linear bearing blocks. They're much more accurate than the ones I used on this machine, because these bearing blocks were just way crooked. And the ball screws work very nice, no backlash, but checking it with a file, they're completely not hardened, so I wouldn't recommend these for a milling machine. And I priced out another long ball screw, because originally I thought, you know, trying to make the gantry move, which is more the traditional way of doing it. But man, these things are not cheap. This set of all three of those is a much better deal.
And I had posted a picture of my CNC machine in progress on Instagram a while back, and somebody had commented, oh, so now you can hate CNC in person, which there's definitely something to that, because I am not sold on CNC. It just takes up way too much time.